I'm going to invite you to be seated because I have to talk to you for a while before I read the lesson. There's a technical term for the reading of Philippians was chapter 2, 1 through 13. And so you cut out those 13 verses and read them. You cut around. And so the Greek word for cut around is pericope. P-E-R-I-C-O-P-E, pericope. And I had a New Testament professor who would be talking, and he would use the word pericope because you use that word at seminary. You never use it again. You get ordained, and part of the ordination service is never say pericope. But Dr. Harrisville would say, now, how would he do this? He would say, you know what the word pericope means, but the great unwashed don't know that word. And he said, you know who the great unwashed are? Well, that's an old, old term for unbaptized people, right? But he would say, the great unwashed are people who don't go to seminary. And I went to seminary. So I know some things you don't know. Like pericope. All that's just preface to say, as I've read things this week and preparing to preach on this parable, there are a few key things I want to just say ahead of time to help you hear what Jesus says to us in these words, okay? I'm such a dope, I should just start it with what I wrote here. Today we hear another parable from Jesus. This is the story Jesus tells of the man who had two sons. He asked them to work in his vineyard. One said yes, but didn't follow through. And one said no and changed his mind. Here's two things I want to talk about before I read this and preach on it. This is kind of from my sermon, but kind of not. One, there has been a read on this parable that has been difficult and harmful and wrong and should be addressed. We in the church have often read this in an anti-Jewish way, saying that this shows that God rejects the Jewish people. They're the ones who said yes, but don't do the Father's will. And now the Gentiles have taken their place as the chosen ones. Let me repeat, that's a wrong read of this parable. This is called supersessionism, and it is a harmful and sad part of the saddest part of our history as Christians. This anti-Jewish way of understanding this parable is wrong, and this wrongness needs to be addressed, especially in a Lutheran congregation. I have a suspicion that most any read of Scripture that reinforces our sense of self-righteousness is a misread of Scripture. Any read of Scripture that makes you think you're better than someone else has probably missed the point. When the gospel writers speak of Pharisees or chief priests or scribes, I have a suspicion that it is more helpful to us to translate that as the religious authorities. Because in our culture, in our lives, the closest thing to Pharisees is pastors, right? And the closest thing to scribes or chief priests are religious and political leaders. That's simply true. And again, as Lutherans, we need to diligently work hard to remove anti-Jewish reads of these stories. That just is, and it's just good to say every 10 weeks or so. Here's the other thing I want to hold up for you. Jesus lived in an honor society, a little different. They view things a little differently than we do. And so what he sets forward for his audience is a choice between two deeply disappointing sons. Each one, you see, dishonors his father. Jesus asks a simple question after he tells the story. Who did the will of his father? Well, it's clear the one who did what the Father asked them to do, did the will of his Father. But if he had asked those he was speaking to when he was done, if he had said, which one is the better son? They would have had to think about that for a while. And they probably would have concluded, well, the one son who at least said yes, at least didn't humiliate his father publicly. So probably the one who said yes is the better son. So Jesus gives a choice between two disappointing sons. And then the father doesn't look so good either, huh? It's really an interesting conundrum that is given to us. And I think it's really super easy for us to miss that. And a third point, I said I was only going to give 2 points, but a third point, this reading follows immediately. At the beginning of the 21st chapter is Palm Sunday entrance to Jerusalem. And then Jesus goes and turns over the tables. And the beginning part of our reading today is about by what authority do you do this? The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, glory to you, O Lord. Oh boy. When he entered the temple, Jesus, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, by what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority? Jesus said to them, I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin? And they argued with one another, if we say from heaven, he will say to us, why then did you not believe him? But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we do not know. And he said to them, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, son, go and work in the vineyard today. He answered, I will not. But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same, and he answered, I go, sir. But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said, the first. Jesus said to them, truly, I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Let us pray. Loving God, indeed you desire life for us all. Help us to turn and live. Amen. We've entered the month of October, and a few of us know the last Sunday of the month is Reformation Sunday, and at that time we take note of Martin Luther nailing the 95 Theses to the door of the church in Wittenberg and all that followed as the Reformation. I mention this often. The first thesis of the 95 is this. When our Lord and Master Jesus Christ said, repent, he willed the entire life of believers to be one of repentance. Here's my volume of Luther's works, 55 volumes. I own at least 10 of them. I've read a bunch of this one. And in my 95 Theses, I have noted in the margin a quote from class. Dr. Jim Nestigan says, after the first thesis, what an incredible thing to say. When our Lord and Master Jesus Christ said, repent, he willed the entire life of believers to be one of repentance. What an incredible thing to say. I have a suspicion that we have such a poor understanding of what repentance really means, that it's hard for us to perceive at all that this might even possibly be an incredible thing to see, to say. We often see repentance as something that is called for by the crazy street preacher with the world is going to end sign, huh? Or that TV preacher who spends a lot of time telling you just how horrible we are and how we are in danger of eternal torment if we don't repent. Yet what if the call to repent is something quite different than a terrible scold from an angry preacher? What if the call to repentance is a call to live in the arms of your loving God? What if it is an invitation to set aside those things that destroy your relationships and to live in another way? The word repentance comes from the Greek word metanoia, that is, to have a transformation of the way of thinking, a change of mind. It is to turn around, to take a 180-degree turn from the direction you are going and to return to God, to go to the One who reaches out to save you. It is this life-giving vision of repentance that made Martin Luther's call to the gospel a movement that changed the world. What do you think? A man had two sons. It's a curious way for Jesus to begin this parable. What do you think? If you look at the story, this is especially curious considering the fact that it's a parable about doing, not thinking. Which of the two did the will of his father? It's such an interesting story. I doubt it's the favorite of any of us, right? There's other parables that are more fun. And maybe part of the reason I find it not so fun is I find that it kind of bites me a little bit. It seems one of those stories Jesus tells that's taken right out of our daily lives. We've all been participants in this story. Perhaps some of you parents heard this from the perspective of the father. Yes, you thought, I've gotten that kind of treatment before. I've heard a yes and seen the actions live out a no. Perhaps, too, we can recall times when we were one of the brothers and we said yes and we did not serve, or when we did behave obediently only after we had tried all the other options, huh? What do you think? A man had two sons. Do you identify with the first son? Do you identify with the second? Surely you've filled each of those roles, the one who said no, yet turned and obeyed, and the one who said yes, but did not. And I think that gives us a sense of the fact that this is a parable that bites a little bit. Which was the better son? Which did the will of his father? It's very clear which son did the will, yet he did not do it without causing pain for the father. How many of you hearing the story, and as I invite you to see which son of you, which of the two sons you are, which of you would rather be neither? How many of you would want to join me and respond, I want to be the child who says yes and then fulfilled the will of the Father? Interestingly, this is not a story of a man who had three sons, because I'm not sure that son exists. Right? Among my favorite passages in Luther's Small Catechism is in his work with baptism. What does baptism mean for daily living, he asks. And then he invites us to respond in this way. It means that our sinful self with all its evil deeds and desires should be drowned through daily repentance, and that day after day a new self should arise to live with God in righteousness and purity forever. I think that one of the deep misreadings of the gospel is there's all sorts of people who think if you belong to Jesus, then you've got it together and you're better. Christianity, apparently, from my life experience, is not a religion for people who are better. Don't take that personally. To live in Christ is to repent each and every day, to turn from our own ways and to live for God. What does baptism mean for daily living? It means that our sinful self with all its evil deeds and desires should be drowned through daily repentance, and day after day a new self should arise to live with God in righteousness and purity forever. Every day for forever, or at least until tomorrow morning when we start over for forever. What do you think? Neither of the sons in the parable followed the direction they chose. How often has our course followed that of the second son? We've been called to serve God by serving others. We've been called to respond to the love and grace that God has shown us, with love shown toward all those around us, even the most unlovable. We have said our yes to God, and then we've been unable to be gracious, even to those closest to us. That first son went through a change of mind, a change of heart, repentance. The second, we see, even with his positive response to the Father, he needed to repent as well. The call of Jesus Christ, your Lord, to repent is a gracious gift. To repent is to experience a shift of the mind and a turning away from your selfishness. It is to come to your senses and to turn to God for everything good. To repent is a growing in love and grace, a restoring of the relationship God desires to have with you, a healing of the rift, and a sending out with love and grace. You see, repentance is not something that comes about when you look inside at yourself long enough to realize how terrible you are. Repentance is a loving response when you look to Jesus and see how great the love of God truly is. Repentance is a gift that flows from faith when you see all God has done for you in Jesus Christ. And indeed, God has given all for you and called you to live in that love always. One day God had a child washed clean by the waters of baptism, made new through the wondrous deeds of Jesus Christ. God has done so much for that child, and God desires to do even more. In order to give that child the best life possible, God called that child, that daughter, that son, God called that child to go into the vineyard and to serve God. And the child said no. And the child said yes. And the child said maybe. Whatever, the child didn't go. Well, maybe the child did go. Or maybe there's a chance for repentance. What do you think? Amen.